thank the Lord for this wonderful time he has given me, especially to come and minister in all these beautiful places. And this morning, I believe with all my heart that God will speak to you and God will revive you and God will strengthen you. Amen. And if you turn your Bibles and read Revelation chapter 2, verses 4 and verse 5.
And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, "By what power or by what name have you done this?"
You know, as I was sitting behind and praying, the Lord gave me a word for the church, and I do agree with what Sister Bina gave, a word of prophecy to the church. You know, there the Bible says so clearly, remember from the height you have fallen, and you have forsaken your first love. And it further says, if you don't come back, I will remove your lampstand. See, every time when the Lord gives a word, he gives a word so that you will receive it. But if you don't receive it, if you fail to receive it, you have to face the music. So the Lord is saying, we need to come back to the Lord in that first love. Keep everything aside. Come back to the Lord and seek His face. Align yourself with God's word. When you align your life, you will see God's mighty hand upon your life. And this morning, I have a word for you, for the church. We will read Acts chapter 4 and verse 7. Somebody can read Acts chapter 4, verse 7.
And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, "By what power or by what name have you done this?"
If you read the Bible very carefully, there is something called spiritual boldness. You know, to live in this world, you need boldness. But to live and to walk in God's kingdom, you need spiritual boldness. They caught hold of Peter and John, and they asked, they were questioned, "In whose name are you doing this? In what power have you done this?" Now we will read from verses 1 onwards. The apostles were still talking to the people when some priests, the captain of the temple guard, and some Sadducees arrived. These men were angry because the apostles were teaching the people that the dead would be raised from death. If you read each word very carefully, it talks and speaks volumes. The apostles, they were teaching. And what they were teaching, the Sadducees, the captain of the temple guard, they did not like that. And what were they teaching? See, can I have three people over here?
No, I want one person to lie down.
We can carry him back.
and you sitting down. Okay, so this person is dead. And this person is mute. So I call this person and I ask the person to pray. For whom will he pray, or whom will you pray? Come on. This man is dead. This man is mute. He's alive. Come on. You'll pray for whom first? No. For whom? The mute. But the apostles were teaching of raising the dead back to life. They were not teaching something over here at this level. They were teaching about something at this level. Are you understanding? They were not teaching or talking about low level of faith, but they were talking about a greater level of faith, a greater intensity in their faith. They were teaching a greater degree of faith. They were not talking about the ground level of faith. You know, today many Christians, you know, we are happy with the ground level of faith. Are you understanding? How long you want to be on the ground level of faith? How long you want to dwell on that level of faith? When will you go up? When will you rise up in your walk of faith? And the Bible says so clearly over there, these men were angry. Who were angry? The priests, the captain, and the Sadducees, or three groups of people, they were angry with Peter and John because they were teaching about a greater level of faith. The devil is least bothered as long as you are in the ground level of faith. Are you understanding? He doesn't even come to you. But the minute you go deeper in your walk of faith, he gets angry. The priests were angry with Peter and John. The captain was angry with Peter and John. And the Sadducees were angry with Peter and John. Why? Because they were teaching about a greater and a deeper level of faith. The devil gets angry when a person is saved. The devil gets angry when you walk in the path of life. The devil gets angry when you walk in a straight way. The devil gets angry when you are saved. But he doesn't stop his work. The more you go deeper and deeper with God in prayer and faith, the more angry he becomes. But that's where you need to take a stand. And that stand, it's called spiritual boldness. You need that spiritual boldness. Today, wherever God placed you, are you spiritually bold to talk about Jesus? Are you bold to testify about Jesus? Where do you stand before the world? How was your walk with the Lord this morning? How was your walk? Is it a superficial walk, or is it an intensifying walk with the Lord?
If you read Daniel chapter 2 and verse 21, he changes times and seasons. God changes your time. He changes your season. Time has come for God to do great things in your life, provided if you intensify your walk in your relationship with the Lord. You have to take a stand for the Lord. And the Bible says, they caught hold of Peter and John, and they threw both of them into the prison. And the Bible says 5,000 people were saved. Not one, not two, 5,000 people. Two people preached, 5,000 people were saved. Today you say that you are a Christian. In all these years, how many people were saved through you? How many people you brought to the church? How many people were saved through your life? How many people were saved through your testimony? You say, God is a living God, God is alive. You know, you sing so beautifully. But how many people did you win? My question is, how many people? Another 2 months, we'll be in December and then January 2017. This 1 year, how many people you led them to the Lord? You know, come out of your comfort zone this morning. You know, stop thinking about yourself, me, my job, my family, my business. Come on, start doing something for the Lord. Start doing something for the Lord. Because when you leave, you will take nothing. You brought nothing into this world and you will take nothing out of this world. But when you have souls, you will take them to the Lord and say, Lord, these are the souls that I have won for you. To be an effective witness for God, you need to be bold spiritually. When they were thrown into the prison, the Bible says they were brought out of the prison. When they were brought out of the prison, the next morning, you see verse 5, it says, they were leaders, elders of the law of Moses, high priests, Cephas, John, Alexander, and other members of the high priest family. See, first time there were three groups, but now you see more people. More people came and stood against Peter and John. More people. Today, what is stopping you from being a witness? From being a witness, who is stopping you? Were you able to share your testimony and your witness, what the Lord has done to your friends? You know, I like to serve people. But more than serving people, I need to serve my God. You know, that today, that is missing. We want to serve people. You don't want to serve God. And these people, they were baffled looking at Peter and John. And they said, these people are simple people, ordinary people, unskilled. They do not have any education at all.
But one thing they took a note, and what was that note? These people were with a man called Jesus. Amen. They were with a man called Jesus. They were with Jesus. That's what the church has to do. You need to be in the presence of Jesus. You need to be in the presence of God. You know, today that is missing. Today that is lacking. And that is the reason the Lord had to speak. He had to give a word of prophecy. They love to serve people, but they don't love to serve God. They don't want to be in the presence of God. Peter and John, they were with this man called Jesus. When was the last time you were with Jesus? Are you spending time with the Lord in prayer? How is your walk with the Lord? Spiritual boldness doesn't come just like that. When you have spiritual boldness, you will have spiritual authority. Today, a lot of Christians, they are not able to exercise the authority what God has given them. And because they are not able to exercise God-given authority, their lives are defeated. They are living in defeat, walking in defeat, and dying in defeat. God didn't call you for that. He called you to be more than a conqueror. He called you to be a victorious Christian. He did not call you to live a defeated life. Peter and John, they were so bold enough. When they saw the crippled man over there, they said, "I don't have silver, I don't have gold to give you. But one thing I have." And what was that one thing? Come on, church. Huh? In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Rise up and walk. You know, it demands spiritual boldness to say that. I don't have silver to give you. I don't have gold to give you. But what I have, I will give you. What I have, I will give you. What I have, I want to give it to you. Rise up in the name of Jesus of Nazareth and walk. This man started walking. Can you say that? I want to challenge you. And I don't want to demotivate you. But I want to challenge your faith this morning. I want to challenge your faith this morning. Rise up. Rise up. Don't be at the ground level experience. Lord, I'm happy, Lord. I have the Holy Spirit. I speak in tongues. Lord, I want to be content with what I have. No. God has called you to do great exploits. God has called you to do great things. God has called you to shake nations. He said, ask of me and I will give you nations. Another translation says, ask of me, I will give you the heathen. I will give the heathen. The heathen. Have you ever stood in that bridge, in that gap and said, Lord, give me the heathen, Lord. I want the heathen. I will pay the price, Lord. I will be a witness. I will testify wherever you placed me, Lord. When you are with Jesus, when you spend time with Jesus, when you spend time in His presence, He gives you that spiritual boldness.
When you are with Jesus in his presence, your identity will change. Amen. The devil has given some identities to some people. Identity called sickness. Some people are sick from January to December. Always sick. Identity of failure. Every time this fellow is a failure. Identity of loss. Whatever he starts, he ends up in loss. Every year that identity is intensifying. You know, the devil has given some people certain identities. When Simon spent time with Jesus, he was changed to Peter. Amen. Jesus said, no longer he will be called Simon, but he will be called Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. His identity changed. Today, what is your identity the devil has given you? When were you born again? How long was your walk with the Lord, but still you are struggling with the same old issues and same old problems? John was changed into sons of thunder. When you spend time with Jesus, your identity will change. When Jacob, who was called a deceiver, a cheater, spent time with Jesus, spent time with God, his identity was changed. God changed his name forever. Every year, we struggle and struggle with the same old issues, with the same old problems. When will you take a break? When will you see a breakthrough? All your life you want to go through? All your life even you want your children to go through? All your life you want even your children's children to go through that? When will you put an end to that? It's time you rise up. It's time you seek Jesus. It's time you spend time with the feet of the Lord. They looked at Peter and John and said, these are simple people, uneducated people. They do not have any education. But how come they were so bold? How come they were talking with authority? And they found the secret that these two people were with Jesus. Church, God has called you to impact this country. God didn't bring you here just like that. You're not here accidentally in this nation. God didn't place you in that company or in that job just like that. He brought you and placed you so that you would impact their lives. God didn't bring Daniel all the way and placed him in Babylon. He didn't place Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego in Babylon. He brought them with a purpose. He brought them to impact the nation of Babylon. And these four young people, they brought a tremendous impact upon the nation. Tremendous impact. Daniel impacted four kings. Four kings, he could impact their lives. Not one, not two, not three, not four kings he could influence. Were you able to influence people who are above you?
Were you able to influence people who are below you with the word? And that change comes when you spend time with Jesus. That transformation comes when you spend time with Jesus. Intimacy brings pregnancy. Intimacy brings spiritual pregnancy. Are you understanding? Intimacy with God and prayer brings spiritual pregnancy. And what comes, you cannot hide it. The whole world will see that. The whole world will come to know what God is doing through you, through your life, through your family. You cannot hide it. You cannot cover it. You cannot hide that. But today, we are living like lukewarm Christians. What will that person think? What will that person say if I talk or tell about Jesus? You know, they looked at these two people and they were amazed. What boldness! From where did they get that boldness? From what source they could get all that? You know, they were stunned. They were astonished. These two are fishermen, ordinary fishermen, but they are talking as if they know everything. They knew everything. They are talking with such boldness, with such power, with such authority. They were baffled. Today the world is looking at you. When the world is looking at you, what are you giving them? Are you giving them the gospel? Are you showing that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life? Or are you keeping quiet and agreeing with them? They never agreed. Peter and John never agreed. They never agreed. Even the prison doors could not stop them. When you walk in that spiritual boldness, nothing can stop you. Nothing can hold you back. Whether you have a job or don't have a job, you will never compromise. You will never compromise. Maybe 3 months or 4 months back, I was sharing with Pastor Manohar how a pastor was tortured and killed by the Naxalites. And last night I showed him the picture. I met this man. They're doing ministry near a place called Bhadrachalam. And the Naxalites warned this man, if you don't stop preaching the gospel, we will kill you. But this man was so bold. He said, whatever you want to do, you go ahead and do with my life, but I will not stop preaching about Jesus, about the truth whom I came to know. Whether you kill me or whether you keep me alive, it will not make a difference. So one day they took this man. They tortured him mercilessly. And they killed him. Two small kids. You can see all the blood stains upon his body. Just because for Jesus. Because he loved Jesus more than anything else in this world. When you have that spiritual boldness, when you have that spiritual authority, come what may, you will stand and live for God. church, I want you to take this as a challenge. God is a zealous God. You know what he said? If you read Isaiah chapter 42 verse 8, I am the Lord. You know, I love that verse so much. That is my name. I will not give that glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. He's a zealous God. He will not give his glory to anyone. But today, are you living for his glory? Or are you living for the glory of these graven images? Anything you lift above God, it is an idol. Anything you give more priority, it's an image. And God doesn't like that. I will not give my glory. I will not even share my glory. And Peter and John, they gave the glory to the Lord. 5,000 people were saved. God was glorified. 10,000 people were added to the church. God was glorified. Is God being glorified in and through your life? Or are you living for the devil's glory? You need to exercise your spiritual authority as a believer. If you don't exercise your spiritual authority as a believer, you will live in failure. You will be a failure. One day a lady came. She's a well-to-do doctor in the city of Vizag. And this doctor was possessed. And the devil started speaking through her. And the devil said, "You Christians, I feel sorry for you. Many Christians do not know the power that is there in the name of Jesus. But right from my boss, Satan, to the lowest fellow in the devil's kingdom, we know the power that is there in the name of Jesus. And every time you say Jesus, the foundations of hell shake. We know that power." These people were using the same name. They were using that same name. "In the name of Jesus, you crippled man, rise up and walk." See, it's easy to throw gold and silver. But to speak like that, you need boldness. You'll have so many questions in your mind. Will this fellow get up or not? If I pray for this dead man, will he come back to life or not? You know, praying for a mute man is easy rather than praying for a dead man to come back to life. See, that's where it talks about your faith. It talks about where you are as a Christian all these long years. And Peter and John, they were talking about the greater level, the greater intensity of faith. Stop dwelling on the ground level. It's time for you to rise up. It's time for you to ask the Lord, "Lord, I want something more that will change my life, change my family, change my personal life, change my family life, so that we will be vessels for your glory." That'll change everything. That'll change your whole situation. And you will never be the same. Your life will never be the same. You will change in everything, and God's name shall be glorified in and through your life. But the stand and the step, what you take, it should be a strong step. It should be a firm step, no wavering. But today Christians are wavering in their walk with the Lord. They have become double-minded. As long as they are with that person, they will take sides and talk with that person. When they leave that person and go to another person, they will take sides and talk with that person. They are wavering. And the Bible says in James chapter 1 verse 8, a double-minded man is unstable. Many Christians, they have become unstable in their walk. They have become unstable in their relationship. I'm so sorry to say this. You have become lukewarm. You are pleasing God one side, you are pleasing even the world on the other side. How long you will serve two people? How long you will serve two masters? How long? The Bible says it is God who arms you with strength for the battle. But today when a battle comes, we are not able to face the battle. We are running away. When a mountain-like problem is coming, we are running away looking at the problem. But when you have spiritual boldness, even that mountain will melt like wax. Amen? It has to melt like wax. But today, looking at the mountain-like problem, we are running away, trying to look out for a shortcut. You know, that is the state of the so-called Christians, the so-called believers. When these people were questioned, they did not run away. The Bible says, Peter filled with the Holy Spirit. On the day of Pentecost, they received. The Bible says, again, before Peter could talk to these people, he received the filling of the Holy Spirit. When was the last time you received the infilling of the Holy Spirit in your life? Every battle that you face, every mountain that you face in your life, you need a fresh infilling. You need the power of the Holy Spirit upon your life for you to win that battle. You cannot rely on 2 years back experience. You cannot rely on last month's experience. You need a new experience every day. And that comes when you are with Jesus. He will not just throw it like that. You need to spend time. You need to seek the face of the Lord. You need to sacrifice it. You need to say, Lord, I have come to you, Lord, let us reason together. You know, I love that verse. Come, let us reason together with the Lord. You have every right to reason with the Lord. You have every right to ask the Lord, why is it happening in my life like this? Why there is no victory? Why there is no success? Why there is no promotion? Why my life is stagnant? Why there is no growth at all? When you reason, He will talk to you. He will change you. He will change you. He will transform you. If you have a desire to see a change, if you are expecting a miracle to happen in your life, it will happen. But when will it happen? Only when you sit at the feet of the Lord. You know, today we have time for everything. We have time for gossip. We have time to go out and there. But we don't have time to sit at the feet of Jesus and say, Lord, I want your power. We sit in the KFC or McDonald's and say, Lord, let your power come upon me. It will not come. It will not come. It will not come. You need to pay the price. Without paying the price,
God will not give it to you. If you want to see the power of God, learn how to pay the price. Jesus paid the price by fasting and praying for 40 days and 40 nights. And the Bible says when he came out with the power of the Holy Spirit. He came out with the power of the Holy Spirit. Today, Christians do not have that power. That power is missing. That power is lacking. And that is the reason you have become lukewarm. Compromising. It's okay. It's okay. People say it's okay. It's okay. How long you want to live like that? How long you going to walk like that? Spend time with Jesus. Take time. When you take time and spend time with the Lord, your life will be a blessing. And God wants you to be a blessing, not a curse. God wants you to be a blessing to the generations that are yet to come. It is in your hands. It is in your hands how to make the best use of it. Seek the face of God. Lord, what do you want me to do, Lord? What are the changes you want in my life? Don't always be a beggar. Always begging and begging. Give me this, give me that, give me this promotion, that promotion. Give me health. Ask the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to do, Lord? Lord, what is in your mind, Lord? What is in your heart, Lord? You brought me to this country, but why did you bring me, Lord? What is that you want me to do in this place? Change your prayer. If you want the mind of God and the heart of God to be revealed, change your prayer. God will open his heart. God will reveal what is in his heart. The Holy Spirit will reveal the mind of God. He will reveal what is God thinking about you. But if you are not willing to change, even if God comes, he cannot do anything. The rich man came so close to Jesus. He came so close to salvation. He lost it. He lost it. Because he loved his money more than God. He was a nominal Christian, not a serious Christian. He took things for granted. And many Christians, you take God for granted. Oh, he's a loving God. No matter how many times I sin, if I go back to him and I say, Lord, please forgive me, he'll forgive me. Separate yourself. God wants you to separate from the things of the world. He wants you to be serious. He wants you to get serious in your walk, in your relationship. Get back. Come back. And people will testify, I see Jesus in that person. I see Jesus in her. That's what these people said. They have seen Jesus in Peter and John. The world has to see Jesus in you. It has to see Jesus in you. Until it sees Jesus, seek the face of God. And you will be a destiny changer and a history maker. Amen.
Lord, I come I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, your grace is more, grace is found, is where you are, where you are, Lord, I am free, holiness is Christ in me. Oh God, how I need.